Hello, and welcome to the podcast, A Living Library of Resiliency, where we have creative conversations. It's a journey involving discussions to process resiliency, an exchange of discovery and healing, and talks among friends to open ears and eyes. Please reach out to me if you'd like to be a guest. I am your host, Rhiannon Berry, a visual artist, social worker, community-minded wellness program developer, psychology student, and wellness retreat coordinator. Episode 9 Plus. Just when you thought Christine Shoemaker does it all, she finds another project to curate that will blow your socks off. Kristen is a plus-sized career artist with her own coaching business. She supports artists with her business planning, PR, social media, and more. Her team has also developed a free peer mentorship program and workshops that encourage artists to reach their greatest potential. Ironically, even with all the success and a trail of awesome art exhibited, sales, and accomplishments, this influential artist continues to strive towards reaching her full potential, something she feels is continuously just out of reach. Kristen lives with an eating disorder and is inspired by this challenge to create art. Whether it's through a performance art exhibit with several artistic takes on her in the nude, an intriguing ideal self avatar comic, or an installation made of hundreds of frozen yogurt spoons, she proves that it is in the perplexities and complications of internal dialogue and social standards where art expression fits into a precious pocket of individual perception.
I've done a lot of things too, all at the same time. I've been director of several art organizations. I've been president of a co-op. I've worn a lot of hats all at the same time, and it's left me little or no time to do my own art. See what you're up to here. And you've got, you know, mentoring coach, critique portfolio review, artist exhibits, opportunities, grants, social media, PR, workshops, representative. Where do you find the time to do all this? And does your art suffer?
Oh, very good question. Well, I actually feel like it's all my art. You know, it's so, yes, I'm a painter, and I do photography and things like that. But I also feel like I love the term cultural producer, mm-hmm. which I had first heard from Sharon Loudon. She produced the book Living and Sustaining a Creative Life, and also Artist as Cultural Producer. And it's about the artist that does exactly just, you know, what you read off. I mean, does more than just paint, is just more in the studio, but works with the community, or, you know, or wears many art hats. And so I just feel like, I mean, I'm all in the art world, and, you know, as an art career. And so, yeah, it's just kind of, I feel like it's all my art. And so I don't feel like, because I do so much as a mentor, I'm missing out being in the studio.
Okay, so nothing is more important than the other in what you do?
No, actually, I never thought of it, but not really, no.
Oh, okay. No. Yeah, because I had to step back from a lot of it, because for 2 years I didn't do one piece of painting, and it just killed me, actually. So,
I have, like, I think somebody had asked me recently, like, if I wasn't able to, or what was the question? It was something like, if I wasn't able to get in the studio regularly, oh gosh, I know this isn't the right question that they asked, but it did have something to do, like, would I be missing out if I didn't have, like, a regular studio practice? And no. And I mean, and I actually don't have a regular studio practice. I mean, I know everybody works in the studio very differently. Sometimes I'll be in the studio like from noon until midnight, you know, painting, but then, you know, for a week I won't be, you know. And so, okay. It's like I don't work 8 to 5 in the studio, or You know, and a lot of times if I'm painting, I pour and drip a lot of paint. And so I have to let it dry in between. And so then I work on other things. So my studio practice is kind of different in that way. But, you know, but I wouldn't be missing out if I wasn't able to get in the studio for, you know, okay, a month because of everything else I do.
So the business side is just as important to you as your actual producing side.
Definitely. And it's just as creative and imaginative also.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And I noticed as well, like you had mentioned in some of your answers to our preliminary questions, that it was almost like a self-guided therapy sometimes, reading between those lines. Some of the work you do as a conceptual artist and helping others. When you paint, is that as well? Like, is that a sort of a self-guided therapy when you're hands-on and as well as planning and organizing?
That's a really good way of putting it. My therapist, which I'm definitely in therapy, you know, she told me that I'm very self-aware. And so when I am struggling with something, she said one thing that I do really well is I seek help, or I seek whatever that looks like. And that could be getting in the studio, just doing mindless collage work or mindless drawing or, you know, things like that to get out of my own head. Or it could be working with others, you know, because like doing service and helping others also gets me out of my own head. So it is definitely all of my art practice. I mean, it's kind of selfish in a way because, you know, by helping others, I'm also helping myself, but it is definitely self-guided therapy. I like that a lot.
But I also think Steve was sort of touching on burnout, right? And you're a self-described generous person.
Yes.
You partner that with ambition and creativity and all the things you are doing. Like, do you ever like hit the edge of burnout?
Oh,
or like full out fall down into it, or
absolutely. I in fact, right now I'm kind of going through a bit of a depression, you know, and I freely talk about this because I know it will help others too. I don't necessarily post it on social media, but you know, but if friends ask, and you know, I've had to tell friends lately because I'm also I'm kind of COVID anxious. I'm overweight. I mean, I'm obese. And so that is one of the risk factors of COVID. Even though I'm vaccinated, I don't want to risk getting sick at all. And so, you know, I don't really go out much. I mean, I've been to a few grocery stores and stuff like that. And I've eaten out, I think, twice in the last year and a half, almost 2 years outside. But, you know, I've basically like stayed within my community here and, you know, and kind of isolated. And so that has brought me some depression. But also because I'm trying to do so much, you know, and also I'm getting Zoom burnout. You know, it, and actually, I should also say before the pandemic, I was getting burnout, you know, because I was going to openings, to art openings, like several times a week, and, you know, trying to do too much. And then the pandemic hit, and it's like, everything stopped. And it's like, oh, you know, I could reevaluate, and I could figure out how to work through burnout or not get burnt out. But then it's a different type of burnout in a way.
Completely different. And studies are starting to come out on it that I find interesting. I did one actual podcast session. We recorded a talk that I did on the changing atmosphere of arts and culture during and how it helped the world, really.
Yes.
And more statistics are coming out on that. So I was telling Steve, and I had found you somehow online. Still to this day, I don't even know how I found you. But I think it was like one image caught my eye or something, and I clicked on it and it went back to your programs. And I was like, oh, well, they're in LA. I'm like, well, the peer mentorship, I don't know. I won't be able to like relate well, but maybe I can participate in this one program. And I did. And yeah, so I'm, you know, happy that I met you through that channel, but it helped me a lot. And it also, like, I was taking psychology counseling. I still am, but I was in some pretty rough material at the time on childhood trauma and abuse and neglect and all of that. And I was writing these long papers on this, these topics, and I hadn't had time to paint in a long time, right? Because my studio work went to the back burner. And this allowed me, your program allowed me to engage with other artists and also be creative and stretch my mind and not feel so like I have to get it perfect for sale. You know, yeah. It was just like, oh, I could just create. And I was matched with some amazing artists who were very intimidating, but I walked away from that. Like just my mind was going and going, and I had an assignment coming up in applied social psychology. And I just applied the concepts of what it did for my healing to get through those, writing those papers and the piece of COVID on top of that, the isolating, you know, I can't go see my friends, can't, you know, got to be careful around the grandparents, things like that. And I just turned it into a project, you know?
Yeah.
It,
you know,
helped me much.
I'm so, it's so like heartwarming to hear that. And, you know, I mean, I'm so glad because we had no idea. I think that was call and response that you had done. And we started that, it was in March of 2020, or we started talking about it, and we may have started March or April, you know, with the pandemic. And it was, you know, well, I mean, what we do, because we're art mentors and we're, you know, I have a team that I work with, and we're always trying to figure out how to support artists. And, you know, we knew that everybody was isolating, and we're like, okay, how can we support, you know, more artists through the isolation? And we sat down and, you know, we put together this, you know, this project, and we went through 13, we had call and response 13, so 13 months of it. And then I needed a break talking about burnout.
I was thinking about you guys. I was like, yeah, I keep putting this stuff online. The artist just grew and grew. And I went to one of the artist talks, and there was like so many pages in the Zoom room. I was like, I can't even see everybody. I'm like swiping.
I mean, I've met more artists through the pandemic because of that than I knew before the pandemic, which is the amazing thing about it. You know, I'm like, where were you, you know, before the pandemic? And I was going to bring it back, and I still am. And I put the call out, and then I realized I'm not ready. I'm just, you know, like I said, I'm going through a bit of a depression, and things are still in transition, you know, with my life and, you know, with my art and all that stuff.
And you have perceived me out right now.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
So I can see how that is just, you know, taking up so much of your time.
I'm curating another show at the same time. So it's like, you know, it's, yeah, there's a lot going on.
There's another similarity between you and Steve, actually.
Taking on too much.
Oh, with perceive me?
Yeah. With the nudity.
Yeah, because we both pose nude, right? I pose nude for other artists too. And it's interesting to hear the comments that are made regarding it, especially when they don't know you're listening. I've heard bad comments, some good comments. You know, I don't know. For me, when you hear the bad ones, they stay with you a lot longer than the good ones. You know, I guess it's ego or whatever, but...
sort of the risk you take.
It does. Yeah.
Yeah.
Posing nude, right?
I mean, thankfully I haven't, I mean, there's trolls on social media and things like that. And I'm like, they're just trolls. You know, I don't take those seriously at all. The show right now is currently in Camarillo. And for those who don't know, Perceive Me was a project that I worked on starting in 2018, where I invited 60 artists to paint, draw, photograph, sculpt, videotape me nude. And I'm, you know, I'm a plus size woman. I weigh, you know, 250, 255 pounds. It may be a little more right now. But, you know, and so it's all about living in a plus size body and everything that that entails. And Perceive Me was all about the idea that oftentimes our self-worth or our validation is based on how we think others see us. And so I wanted to see myself through other artists' eyes. And so that's where that started. And so it started the exhibition. It culminated in an exhibition. 60 artists are participating, and it was at California State University, Los Angeles in January, February of 2020, and then the pandemic hit. and it was going to travel, but everything got postponed. So finally it came back, and it's in Camarillo, California right now. And then it's going to the Museum of Art and History in Lancaster in October, November, December. But so Camarillo is a little more of a conservative town. And there was just an artist talk yesterday, and the director, you know, he was talking about the different remarks that they're getting from people coming in. And, you know, some of them are surprised and shocked. And he said somebody walked in, and they kind of walked through the exhibit fast. And then they were like, I just don't know. It was an older woman. She's like, I just don't know. And walked into like the gift shop area, and then like walked out and walked slower. And she's like, okay, I kind of get it. And he said, there's all sorts of comments like that. People bring their kids, you know, their daughters to see it, and they come back. And that's the amazing thing that, you know, I'm excited to put out there, is, you know, that this conversation, I've heard also this conversation extends beyond the exhibition, but when people, families get home and continue to talk about it. And that's exactly, that is a successful exhibition for me.
Yeah. So would you say that you're the subject and the artist, or the conceptual artist and the subject?
Yeah, it's definitely a conceptual artwork. It's also, I consider it a performance. From the time that I started working with the artist, the collaboration between the artist and I, I'm the artist of the whole project. So it's definitely something that's maybe new, something unique. I'm the artist, I'm the curator, the organizer, the
everything.
The everything, yeah. And it is collaboration, you know, working with the artist, and it kind of encompasses everything I do, you know, because I am a curator. I'm also a community organizer. You know, I'm all about community engagement. So I'm engaging with the art community as well as with the audience. And so it brings everything that I do together.
Yeah, no, I'm curious, you've mentioned that you're the artist in this. When I first saw this and I saw your video on it, and you mentioned that, I was looking at it more as you're the curator, the muse, the subject matter, but not really the artist, because the artist that created whatever they did, it was their creation, right? So they would be considered the artist. But
how do you perceive it? That?
Yeah.
Because it was my idea. I mean, you know, we're living in our, you know, modern and postmodern society, where Duchamp, you know, he talked about art is about the idea. You know, it doesn't matter what the medium is, but it was my idea from the beginning. I'm the artist. I am an artist. I conceived of, this is my project. It's about me. It's for me. It's for the audience. It's for the artist. And so, in that case, like, I'm the artist collaborating with other artists.
Okay.
And so, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that makes more sense for me now. So
yeah. I mean, and it's conceptual. I mean, it is sometimes hard to wrap your head around. And I do talk about it in a lot of different like artist talks, because a lot of people, you know, especially the public who don't necessarily understand like postmodern art and, you know, things like that, they don't quite get it. But it and I even, you know, have trouble sometimes, or not have trouble, but explaining, like, when I put the title on the wall, you know, it's Perceive Me by Christine Shoemaker, you know, not curated by, but by, you know, because it wouldn't happen, you know, if I wouldn't have come up with the idea. And curators come up with ideas like this all the time, but because I'm also the subject of it, there's that extra layer in there, you know. And I think adding that it's a collaboration helps, definitely, and a performance, yeah, in a way.
It's a lot of things.
Yeah.
I just wanted to mention, some of the pieces are so beautiful. Like, do you feel more beautiful now after having, like, seen some of these pieces that were created of you?
No.
Oh my goodness.
It's, you know, it's something I've thought about a lot, and I've been asked that question before too. The work is beautiful. I mean, there are so many amazing pieces, and they're magical, and they're, there's something about them. But I like, especially because I've looked at them so much, and because of my role in everything, they're more art objects to me now. I kind of feel like the performance, you know, of working with the artists, like when the artists, like a lot of them came to my studio and they photographed me. There were a few artists where I went to their studio and like they drew me in person while I was there. But a lot of the time they either came to my studio or like my friend Danny, we actually went to the Mojave National Preserve in the desert, you know, for a couple of days, and she shot me there. And so, like working with the artists and the performative nature of that and how I was feeling at that time, I think was more personal and more expressive and individual than actually the feeling about it afterwards.
I think comparable though, like I watched one of the talks that you had posted, and you used to carry around skinny pictures, didn't you?
Yes. Yeah.
And these, you know, pictures of yourself, you know, I have a few on my phone. I look back, I go, oh my God, when I was working out, I was hot. Right. But at the time I was like, I could get skinnier. So I think a lot of women, maybe even men, I don't know, Steve, you can speak to this, but, you look back at these pictures and you realize I took that for granted. Right.
Yeah.
And I almost feel like give yourself some time and you're going to look back on a lot of these things and you're going to have the same feeling.
You know, absolutely. I mean, it wasn't an art project at the time, but it turned into one, carrying around my skinny photos.
Yeah.
It was, you know, I did it for inspiration, you know, thinking that one day I would be that, you know, that way again. And then, you know, and I mean, it's been, I don't want to say a struggle. I mean, it has been a struggle, but like life is confusing. It's like one day I want to be thin. The next day I want to love my body as I am. And I mean, there's so many mixed messages out there. There's so many, like I follow many Instagram accounts from fat activists and, you know, from like inspirational quotes and inspirational accounts that are all about like learning to love your body as you are. And, you know, talking about self-worth and, you know, all of that. And I do want that, but I also want to be thin. So
it's a lot more freeing to accept yourself than it is to try to be thin.
And it's probably easier.
I mean, it is. There's a balance, right? Because you want to be healthy.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
I think just the idea of wanting to lose that extra weight, even for myself, when I've committed to modeling for somebody very shortly, and I'm trying to firm up a bit, lose a bit more weight. It's never enough. But even when I see the work afterwards, I'm sort of detached from it. It's not really me. It's an art piece that yes. I can enjoy. But while I'm modeling, I'm still a little self-conscious during that time. And yeah. I think we all go through that.
No, definitely. I look back at some of the work. And so the first official piece in the project was by Amanda Mears, and it was a drawing. And she had asked me to be in her project where she was drawing people. It's a beautiful drawing. And so I, you know, met with her three different times, and I stood there. I was like in my power pose and in my power stance pose. And I stood there for 2 hours each time, and it was hard on my body. I mean, you know, like a 230 or 40 pound body standing there. I mean, I did take many breaks, excuse me, but, it was, I think that was maybe in August of 2018, if I remember right. And I look back, so throughout that year is when I met with the other like 55 or 56 artists. And I look back and I'm like, and I don't know if it was her perception of me, but in that piece, I'm like, I was thinner then than I am in any other, you know, piece in the show, basically. And it's like, I wouldn't mind being back then, you know, back to that weight, even though I was still uncomfortable. So, and then there's one other piece. So I invited two artists to be in the project who actually had done work, like invited me to model for their projects before I even thought of Perceive Me. And Perceive Me actually came out of a conversation that I was having with Amanda Mears when she was drawing me. And so Chris Blevins Morrison had taken a beautiful photo of me for her project in like 2014. I'm holding up a sign that says, "You are beautiful," or it's a piece of art that I own that says, "You are beautiful." And I was thinner then, you know, it was 4 years before I started Perceive Me. And so, you know, it's interesting to look at those pictures. Currently right now I'm in a 12-step program because of my eating disorder. And so I've thought about, I started it almost a year ago. It'll be a year ago, September 29th. And, you know, I was like, I should be thin. I was like, I'm in this program. Why am I not thin? And then I was like, well, if I'm thinner, do I want to continue the project and have the artists like, you know, do a piece of me thin? And like, what does that mean? And I'm like, no, probably not. So, I mean, there's, I don't know, so many different like layers and meanings and tangents and issues and related to all of it.
It sounds like it. It's complicated, isn't it?
Yes.
Definitely. I know I've gone up and down a lot, and I'm a sturdy girl. I was always an athlete. So I've always been bigger. Like, for instance, I've always been bigger than my brother, who's a year older than me, right? Whether I was like all muscle or whatever. There's never been a point in my life where I wasn't a bigger girl, I guess. Like, I wasn't always heavy, but I was always athletic. Right.
Yeah.
So I kind of get what you're saying, because it's like you look at those as like different versions of yourself, almost as like different people sometimes too. It gets really complicated.
Definitely.
And your self-worth is attached to those different sizes. I still keep a bin full of clothes, right? Like, why do I keep this bin full of clothes? But I do. But yeah, like, it is very complicated. And like, you describe it as an eating disorder.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a binge eater. You know, I mean, ice cream is my food of choice, and it's a comfort. It numbs me. It's like a drug, you know. I mean, and I could say that actually with sugar, it's a drug. It's like, you know, I use it the same way, you know, people drink or people, you know, smoke, or I don't know about smoking pot, but that's a whole other thing. But, you know, I mean, do heroin, and you know, it's to numb. It's to many it's to different take you things. Away.
Yeah.
And I'm going through it right now. You know, I was abstinent from sugar it was 158 days, 7 or 8 months ago. And I actually lost 20 pounds.
Wow.
And then something happened and it just
came back.
I just, clicked. Oh, and yeah. Turned and,
yeah. It has to be a whole lifestyle change, right? You try these gimmicks and then, you know, sometimes it works for people, but those people are always the exception, I think.
Yeah,
but I'm change everything and make it a lifestyle.
Yeah, I mean, and it's, you know, I really see the value in 12-step programs, and so, you know, I'm I will be abstinent again. It's just like, you know, working through it with my I need a sponsor, but working through it with my therapist, and you know, and also like I deal with it through my art. You know, it's like, you know, like she said, I'm self-aware, and I do that because like I journal all the time, and you know, but definitely like talking about it and helping others again as a way for me to work through it. And that's what I do with my art. So,
and you've probably gotten a lot of feedback from Perceive Me that people feel like inspired by you to be more self-accepting and maybe even, you know, be okay with their weight, but also try to live a more healthier lifestyle, because you're bringing attention to so many different aspects.
Absolutely. And it's not even just about like weight, but it's, you know, I talked in an artist talk recently, I shaved my head for a performance art piece a few years ago. And I wanted to show that we're not defined by our physical attributes, you know, so like we're not defined by if we have short or long hair or, you know, I mean, the color of our skin or, you know, and I mean, I'm saying that very simplistically because, you know, I mean, of course, there's so much more to it. And, you know, because people have been defined by those in the past. And so, but I want to bring attention, you know, to all of these so we can talk about them, you know, whatever it is. Like, you know, when I shave my head, I was working in an emergency room at the time, which is a little more conservative. I go in there and there's a male nurse. He's like, "Oh my God, what did you do? Grow your hair out." And he was calling me G.I. Jane. And I'm like, really? I'm like, you know, he has no idea, you know, who I am or what I do. Or, you know, I was, you know, people mistook me for a man, thought I was lesbian, thought I had cancer. You know, I mean, all of these different labels were put on me because I shaved my head. And it's like, you know, how many men during the pandemic grew their hair out, you know? And I mean, look at like the 60s and 70s, you know, I mean, men I know were ridiculed for having long hair then. It's like, why do people need to judge us based on how we look? And that really, it becomes internalized. And it's like, okay, how do we let that go? How do we walk past that? And it's hard. I mean, I don't know if we can
trace that back too, right? Like I can trace back my body issues. Like I said, I've always been a little bit bigger. People are always like, how come, you know, you're bigger than, or, you know, we'd go to a carnival and I jump on a like guess your weight thing and I was always heavier, you know, like I can trace it back to those things, but also just like, you know, advertising has a little bit to do with it, but also just like situations, like I went on a date and a guy looked at me and said, "You're hot, but if you lost 15 pounds, you'd be smoking." Well, how long do you think that's stuck in my head for?
Yep.
You know, yep. Try to lose those 15 pounds. No, I didn't. I never went on another date with him again. But
yeah, good.
Don't blame you.
But there's so many of those little things in life, right?
Yeah.
Mention things to you and you're like, "Well, I'm going to shake this off. I'm a strong person." But really, it just kind of like gets in there. And
it does. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like when I posted a lot of the photos of me and being used as art, and some of them were nude. 80% of the posts that people mentioned on there were sort of, they were trying to be funny, but they were really negative, like, "Oh, I'll never be able to see that, unsee that," or "My eyes are burning." These are friends, you know, and you sort of expect a little bit better from them, but
the mentality and the culture, like, it's exactly what you expect people would say.
Yeah.
I think it may be because I'm a male too. And
you can take
males more, aren't as acceptable as female nudes really in our culture right now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But don't they know you're an artist and you're sensitive?
Oh yeah. Well, I don't know if they know I'm sensitive, but, it's just.
Well, you must not be if you're posing nude, right?
You know what? That's the like people I'm doing it for, I trust. And it's a real trust thing. And they are accepting. I used to host Life Drawing for 6 years. So we hired models from 90 pounds to 350 pounds, 19 years old to 65 years old, men, women, all races. And each one was a challenge to draw.
Yeah.
That's how I got into it. We had models that didn't show and I had to step in because my students are here. So, you trust them. Yeah, you trust them. So.
And that's, you know, for Perceive Me, I get asked that question a lot because there are several men in Perceive Me also. And it's like, how did you feel, you know, modeling nude for all of these people? And, you know, it's interesting because I was just thinking about it earlier today, how I have a hard time trusting people. But with artists, you know, there was complete trust, you know, maybe because I get it, you know, because I'm an artist too. And they're professional. This is their career. This is what they do. And so I don't know, there's something I need to
they're kin, about. Right?
Like, yeah. Yep. Exactly. I mean, they're not, you know, I mean, I knew, like, I mean, and I, most of the artists, like, I curated, so I already knew anyway. And if somebody reached out to me, you know, I researched them and looked them up and, you know, so it wasn't just, you know, somebody that I didn't know, you know, which also helped.
A little bit of familiarity is nice.
Yeah.
One of the things I really found interesting was your Gracie Kendall strips. It's you talking to your avatar, like in multiple blocks. And it was interesting to see how you were relating and your avatar was relating back to you. You want to talk a little bit about that, or?
Yeah. You know, actually, I may be doing that again. You know, I'm thinking of bringing her back. I mean, she's still around, but Gracie Kendall is my avatar in the virtual world of Second Life. And I created her in 2006 when my aunt and uncle, who were like kind of old school hippies from the 60s and 70s, they had read about Second Life in Spin magazine, the music magazine, and about how musicians were going into Second Life and streaming concerts from their home studios. And so they went in to check it out and they're like, oh my God, we met all these artists in Second Life. They're like, you need to bring your art in Second Life. And so I did. And when you go into Second Life, you create like an avatar or a computer representation of you. And so, you know, I'm like, if you can be anything you want, you know, I was tall, thin, blonde, beautiful, you know, I dressed very classy. It was still my personality, but she was definitely like my quote ideal self. And so I went into Second Life and I uploaded, you know, digital images of my art, of my paintings, and I started selling virtual copies of them. And in Second Life, there's also an economy there. So I could like cash out. And I mean, I probably sold a few thousand dollars, you know, US dollars worth of art, which was great. So within Second Life, I also was a huge part of the art community there. And I started doing more performance art within Second Life, which carried over into the real world. And I was working on my master's thesis at the time. I was getting my degree in art history, and then I transferred to studio art. And my professor at the time, I showed her my paintings and I also showed her Second Life, and she was more interested in what I was doing in Second Life. And so she started to ask me about my avatar. She's like, why is your avatar tall and thin? And at the time I was overweight. I probably weighed 180, 190. So I weighed a lot less than I do now. But you know, she was still a lot thinner than I was. And so at that time is when I also realized I had an eating disorder. And so I started to go to therapy for that and started to really deep dive into, you know, to all of these different things. And so I think I started, I was doing research for my master's thesis, and I read an article from Stanford about how your avatar inspires you in real life. Like they did studies where they would have people in the computer, you know, in front of a computer, their avatars would be on the treadmill and the people would actually want to go work out. Excuse me. So I started to think about, or to see, I'm like, okay, does Gracie inspire me? Can she inspire me to be thin? You know, to be like she, so Gracie dated a lot in Second
Life. Like to be tall and blonde.
Yeah, well, there's no way I could be taller than I am. Yeah. But I, you know, so my master's thesis actually, so what I did was I started out the project by, I'm like, okay, how do I compare Gracie and myself? So I took a photo, like a snapshot, a virtual snapshot of Gracie, and I juxtaposed it next to a photo of me. And I did that every day for like 159 days. And I took like a dozen of them to my professor and I showed her, and she's like, you know, I see these conversations between the two of you forming. And the photographs included like both of us working out at the same time or looking at art at the same time, you know, doing similar things. And she's like, I see these conversations forming. So I learned how to make comics, you know, digital comics. And I actually started writing out conversations. And I even asked, I'm like, is this kind of schizophrenic? Is this like, are people gonna think I'm crazy for doing this? And you know, she's like, no, I mean, we all have these voices that, you know, we talk to. And I kind of thought of Gracie as like that hidden ego that sit on your shoulder. She kind of became a cheerleader, and actually now I know it's, if you're in a 12-step program, you understand about like a higher power. I realized that she was probably my higher power at the time, you know, or like my ideal self, who I want to be. And so by thinking of her in that way, that's one of the reasons I want to bring her back. But so I started having these conversations and I created the comics. And then for my master's thesis, I actually decided to to work on turning into Gracie. So at the time, like I had like a blonde bob. It was like shoulder length. It was dark, dark blonde. I went and had my hair colored platinum blonde. I got a nose ring because she had a nose ring. I went shopping to buy clothes that she wore. I actually had a solo show of my paintings at the time, so that I was able to take photos for that. I did a video and I also did photos of both her and I for the exhibition. And it was called My Life as an Avatar. And so that was my first kind of deep dive into like body image and ideas of beauty and really thinking about myself, my own identity, and where that, and then that was in 2010. So it's like ever since then, you know, it's definitely been a part of my art.
Yeah, I sort of looked at it as she was your art therapist because yeah. You kept asking her questions and she would give you responses, and I kept wanting to read the next one and the next one and the next one to find out where this is going.
Definitely. I mean, she was like the sarcastic maybe sister or something. She's like, stop it, you know. I mean, yeah, definitely.
That's pretty immersive. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, I'm gonna by bringing her back, you know, in a way it'll be therapy again, you know, using her to, I don't, you know, think about like the inner child within, you know, healing the inner child, or, you know, using her as a tool in a way, along with art, which, you know, as artists, that's what we do. You know, it's like, whether it's drawing, painting, you know, writing, poetry, it's, you know, we figure out what works for us and how that can help heal us or challenge us or, and so, so yeah, I'm looking forward to working with her again.
Yeah, you had a series of 1,000 avatars that you created, right?
Yeah.
Any of those other ones you're going to bring back to, or are they just the one series and that was it?
So that series was actually, because I was delving into identity in Second Life, Second Life is made up of users from all over the world. And, you know, anybody could log in and create an avatar and live and work and build and, you know, create music, you know, do anything like that. And so, and it was just fascinating to me how different people like rendered their avatars, like what their avatars look like, whether if they were, you know, no matter what gender they were in, you know, the real world, they could be an opposite gender or no gender or a different color, or, you know, they could be a horse or a cabbage, or, you know, and it's like, so the 1,000 Avatar Project was actually where I photographed, actually it ended up being 2,000 different avatars. And how they represented themselves. And so it was kind of like a carryover of my work with identity, but I wanted to talk about identity in general. And so I published actually a couple of books on Blurb and had a few essays written, you know, about Second Life and its importance. And it's really interesting because virtual reality and virtual worlds are, you know, coming into their own even more today, especially with the pandemic and, you know, things like that. And Second Life is still going. People still log into it. So same thing with video games. You know, I'm not a gamer or anything like that, but, you know, World of Warcraft, you know, it's like you hear stories all the time about, you know, the disabled, you know, using it and being able to walk when they couldn't walk, you know, and so, and how much it helped them. And
did this like exercise help with your anxiety? Because I'm sure that's another like big reason people get so involved with their creating their avatars.
No, definitely. I don't know about my anxiety per se. It helped with my shyness at the time, you know, something that, you know, I talk about in Perceive Me, and as far as perception and self-worth and validation, part of my self-worth comes from the idea, like, you know, I'm 48 and I've never been married. I don't have kids. You know, I've dated here and there, but I've never been asked out on a date per se. I've always been the one asking because I'm like, I'm not going to wait. And even then, you know, it's like few and far between. Could just also be because I'm picky. And it's like, and I also like living alone, you know, all that
you
stuff.
Like, but the freedom.
I know. Yeah. And it is complicated, but you know, for a long time in my mind, my self-worth, because of like what I've seen in society and, you know, so many of my friends being married and dating, and it's like, nobody asked me out. So I'm not worthy. I'm not enough. And so like, you know, I'm having to rewire my brain and I know it, but, you know, but that's also where Perceive Me came from. And so with my avatar, by creating this, my ideal self, this tall, thin, beautiful woman, I had attention, you know, in Second Life. And the attention first came because of my avatar, which is a whole other thing as far as like, you know, it's okay as an outer appearance. It like almost proves my thesis that, you know, it is outer appearance that attracts people first. But then it was me all the time. Like I wasn't acting, it was my personality. And that's how I kept, you know, like kept the men I talked to, that I kept, you know, going with that. And so it, where was I going with that? Totally like,
I think sort of like along the lines of, it's like living inside of a, like a phenomenon almost. Like you are either in this, you know, looks are what people see first. And then that sort of like dictates how you see the world, how people see you, how you engage with people, how you perceive other people, and then how the world sends that energy back to you. Or you're in this whole other situation where that's where you become eccentric and reclusive and things like that, because now all of that stuff doesn't matter. You're in your own head and you're happy with who you are. Like, how dare you be happy not without a husband and children and as an artist and doing all of these things that you find, you know, inspiring to others, but to yourself as well, that keep you going. That's all about you.
Yeah,
you know, it has nothing to do with your appearance, or it has to do with your appearance, but not that usual attachment.
Yeah. I feel like I'm in the middle somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, I think about that a lot. I also feel like, you know, if I put myself out there more, if maybe I, I don't even know. I mean, I don't even want to say it that way, but.
Do you have regrets about not dating more?
No, not in that way. No, but because I know it's just where I've been at the time and who I am and all that stuff. But I know it's also because of like my own like confidence, you know. If I was more confident in myself, I think I'd be more open to dating and, you know, things like that. So,
yeah. So you're still working on that. Like, yes, you were saying, you're still working exactly on it. Maybe you'll be working on it for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
But it's almost like you are your own avatar sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know,
you don't need her anymore. You are. Yeah.
I mean, I'm a work of art, you know, I'm a work of art in process, you know. I think we all are, you know, in our own ways. Some people, sure, say I'm not an artist, I don't do anything. And it's like, yes, you are. We all are.
I
know. Are.
I hate when I hear that. Or like, yeah, I would pull people into a painting class and they're like, I'm not artistic at all. And I'm just like, what art teacher told you that
in grade two? Yep.
Yeah.
And it's like, they may be the best gardener or the best baker. And I'm like, oh my God, that's an art in itself, you know, or even, yeah, a mathematician. That's an art. Oh my God. It just totally goes over
art
my head.
Storytelling. Yes. I find fascinating.
Exactly.
You can have somebody who's the best storyteller ever. I have a sister who's like the best storyteller, and there's six of us, and there's six girls and four boys. She is the best storyteller of all of us. And she's the quickest one to say she wishes she was as talented as, you know, some of us. And I'm just like, you don't, yeah, even realize how talented and creative you are.
It's like, where did all this come from? This like lack of self-confidence. It's like, ugh.
Yeah, I know. You need to take the world and shake it.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Was there any one art exhibit that you did that you finally felt you arrived as an artist, or is that more for your teachings and your, you know, all the presentations, social media, PR? Does that make you feel more of an artist?
Good question. You know, when I first realized I had an eating disorder, or actually when I first, I had a panic attack when I, in 2008, and that's actually kind of when I realized I had an eating disorder, even though I had had it for a long time before that. I started going to therapy more regularly, and I was working on my graduate degree at the time, which is where that panic attack came from, I'm sure. But, I was in therapy and I was talking to the therapist, and I think I was telling her about somebody who was dressed really cool and she looked like an artist, and I wanted to be that. I wanted to look like that. I wanted to dress like her. And, you know, I wanted, to look like an artist. And she's like, but you are an artist. She's like, and so I started talking about it and thinking about it. And this was in 2008, and I've been painting since 1998. And that's when I first started taking painting classes at the junior college where I lived. And I was selling my paintings. I worked in an emergency room at the time, and I'd take my paintings in, and the doctors and nurses would buy them. And, so I was already selling. And so I knew I was an artist, but there was a disconnect. And so I don't think it was an exhibition per se, but it was definitely therapy that helped me see, okay, I am an artist. You know, I don't need an exhibition to tell me that, or, you know, and honestly, it's like, what does arrived mean? You know, success, I ask that to my artists that I mentor. What is success to you? Because it's different for everybody.
Yeah.
It's like, for me, success is supporting other artists. It's like, but success is like hearing from artists, just like, you know, Rhiannon at the beginning, you know, talking about how much call and response, you know, meant to you and what it did.
On so many levels. Yeah.
Yeah.
It pulled like some pieces from that.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
It's like, if I can like help other artists in that way and see the, like, what is it called? The, when you throw a stone in the water, the ripples. Thank you. You know, if I can see the ripples of something that I start, and, you know, and just watch that grow, that is success to me. And just, you know, and it's already arrived. I've already arrived there. You know, and I just hope that I can keep, just from how I live my life. And, you know, one of the ways, I mentioned that, you know, I have been going through some depression, and especially through the pandemic, you know, I know a lot of people are reevaluating their life, you know, what they want to do with their life. Sure. And for the last few years, I've thought about starting an artist residency. Like, you know, I live at the brewery in downtown LA, which is a big art community here. They have live work lofts, and I'm very grateful and lucky to be here during the pandemic, but I also live like 100 feet from the 5 freeway. It's like, you know, it's like the concrete jungle. And I want nature, you know, so I've thought about, you know, like starting a residency somewhere in nature. And
I've actually thought of that as well.
Yeah.
I read an article not too long ago on something like that, but for single parents. And I thought to myself, when my son was really young, how wonderful would that opportunity have been for me?
Yep, exactly.
You know,
exactly.
So then the wheels start turning.
Yep. I mean, ever since, like, and it could have been from my professor in grad school, I'm all about creating your own opportunities. We have to, you know, because there's so many times where there isn't, like, what we need isn't available, like whether it's gallery representation or whether it's a residency like that or whether whatever it is, it's like, well, why not do it yourself? You know, I mean, we live in this artist DIY art world. We have to do it ourselves. And so in the meantime, because, you know, of course, I can't afford to start anything right now or to buy a place, or I'm going to go to residencies. And I realized I haven't taken a vacation in at least 10 years. I mean, at least. And I'm like, I need it. So I'm actually going to an artist residency December 20th down in the San Diego area. And I'm only taking my phone. I'm not taking my computer. I'm taking all my art supplies. I'm taking books to read. And that's it. I'm just like getting away. Wonderful. And so I hope like that I help by doing, you know, I help by example, you know, I lead by example, you know, in so much of my life, whether it is body image, whether it's as a mentor, whether, you know, whether it's just being an artist in the world. And so
I think you will be leading by example, because like you were saying, a lot of people had to reevaluate a lot of, including artists. And they're all like, okay, so you have like, the way I see it is, you can go back to normal or as normal as possible, or you can embrace those revelations that you had while we had this downtime worldwide. You can write those down and not forget them, not forget the promises you made to yourself during this time, and commit. Yours is going out into nature, reconnecting with the natural part of you that's also going to encourage your creativity and rejuvenate your soul. And when you share your experiences with other people, it'll be like, oh, I couldn't put that quite together. Like the idea, I know I wanted to go out to nature, but I couldn't figure out how to do it. But look what Christine's doing. And, you know, they'll follow suit, or maybe they'll come up with something similar for themselves. But I do think it'll be inspiring, because I think people look to you for new ideas and inspiration.
Right now I'm going through this thing also, you know, I mentioned earlier that before the pandemic, I was going to like 6, 7, 8 openings a week, you know, art openings. I mean, mostly supporting friends, you know, and supporting, because, you know, I mean, I love my LA art community and I have so many artist friends in LA. And, but it was just so taxing and it was exhausting. And on my body, it was so much. And so during the pandemic, when everything stopped and I didn't have to go anywhere, I'm like, I like this. Like, I do not want to go anywhere. And so now that things are like slowly opening up, and thankfully in California, things are lower, you know, than most every other state in the United States. You know, I mean, so many of my artist friends are getting out there again and having shows, and I am being invited to shows. And I feel like right now, I mean, this could be part of my depression too. It's like, I feel so much guilt for not going to their openings. And so I've been like slowly sending out notes, you know, to specific friends explaining, you know, what I'm going through. I mean, I'm not gonna, I have to be honest. And every single one of them is like, I totally understand, you know, you have to do what is right for you. And it's like, it just makes me realize that we internalize so much. It's like, we don't even, nobody cares. Scenario.
Yeah, nobody's thinking about you.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. I need to like, let that go. And like,
yeah, you know, well, you want to show up. That's your thing. You want to show up for other people.
Yes.
That's your generosity. And that's why I was talking about how generosity is linked to burnout, right?
Yes. Yeah.
You don't want to have to say no. But if you hit a wall, the world will force you to say no.
And, you know, it always comes back to the whole, you know, that I hear this so much lately, the airplane scenario, like we have to give ourselves oxygen before we give it to everybody else, you know, because we have to take care of ourselves first in order to take care of others. And I try to remember that and to think about that. And I know that everybody else understands, but it's just, you know, working through the guilt and the, you know, all of that, you know, but I mean, it's part of being a sensitive artist also getting back to that.
Yeah. Dealing with rejection. And
yeah.
Steve has an exhibit open right now, don't you?
Yeah. The Scratchboard Society, International Scratchboard Society.
Oh, wonderful.
Ontario is just starting to get back to in-person shows again, which I've missed now, and I'm itching for them. So I just had an opening and we had a fair good turnout for a Friday afternoon. And yeah, it was really good to finally get one under the belt, you know. And I also attended another art show, the Niagara Falls Art Gallery.
Which won the Mayor's Choice Award.
Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you, yeah. But you know, it's funny, preparing for this broadcast, just yesterday, I think it was, I sent Rhiannon a Facebook post from a Facebook friend that had shared your post of a workshop that you've got coming up. So all of a sudden you're coming up on my feed through somebody else, which is really great.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Yeah. It, excuse me. I mean, it, I don't know if I like the word hustle, but I started my company Shoebox PR 7 years ago, and I quit my emergency room job, you know, and I wanted to be in the art world full time. And so thankfully I have like, I have the administrative background along with like the artistic temperament. And so, you know, and I wanted to help artists. And so I, you know, I hustled to do like, I did PR for artists. And over the years, it's turned into more of like a business coaching, art mentorship. And it's, we changed our name to Shoebox Arts recently. And we've worked with over 180 artists past and present. And thankfully during the pandemic, most of our artists have stayed with us and, you know, because they wanted the support. And we upped our game. We met with them every 2 weeks on Zoom to give them the support that they needed. We also started, you know, call and response. I started a free peer mentorship program where I paired artists to like mentor each other. And we recently,
yeah, I love that idea.
Yeah, thank you.
It's so needed. I've always said that, like, even before I was like, even an emerging artist, I'm like, how come there's no peer mentorship program specifically for arts? And then I started looking into it and there was a few, but
yeah,
not
yeah.
like yours, not as it like you offer a whole package.
Yeah. I mean, there's, you know, we have paying packages, but I have also, we have a nonprofit also, but we haven't done anything with it. So we're starting to work on figuring out how to do that because I also, I mean, I couldn't afford to like pay somebody to do PR for me.
That's,
you know,
the whole
I
roadblock with the yeah. artists. Like I see these ads all the time. I even get emails all the time, like, hey, you're SEO. And I'm like, who can afford that right now? I'll take care of my WordPress. Thank you very much.
Exactly. So I want to be able to help artists who can't afford it. And so by offering the free peer mentorship program, you know, pairing artists that way, that helped. And then the most recent thing, we started our workshop, our 6-month workshop. We're halfway through our first one. And it's specific. We meet twice a month. One of the meetings is like where we go over like goals, business plan, website, social wow. media. The other meeting that month is where we do virtual studio visits. So there's 18 artists in my current workshop, and it's been great. We're forming a community. It's they're helping each other, and it's all over. It's on Zoom, so you don't have to be in Los Angeles or California. Or you can be in any state or any country. Yeah. And it's only $600 a year for the workshop period. And if you're in California, you can even apply for a grant through the Center for Cultural Innovation. And I know there's other grants in similar areas to help artists with professional development workshops. So mm-hmm. we put it out there. I'll be doing another one starting in January that people can sign up for. And it's, I mean, it is a way because I have two other full-time employees that I work with who I've been able to keep on during the pandemic. And, you know, it's just a way to like keep the business going also while supporting artists in different ways that they can afford. So, you know, I'm very lucky to have a great team and, you know, who we come up with like just different ideas and, you know, different ways of doing things. And right now I'm also in transition. I'm going to be getting a new art studio and it's the same building that I live in, just a second space and opening up like a physical art gallery, Shoebox Projects, which was my alternative art space. And so it's like, there's so many kind of things out there to help support artists and, so yeah, just in this huge kind of transition right now that I can't wait till it's all over and things are settled.
Oh, you do have a lot going on.
Yes. And,
so will the new studio be under the not-for-profit?
No, because it's my art studio. Okay. So it's, but we have thought about, because I'll have a couple of empty spaces available. And so we thought about doing studio residencies under the not-for-profit where artists could submit like a proposal and get free studio space for like 2 months at a time. But like they, because I'm all about like socially engaged work, you know, or social practice, you know, things that are that help the community in different ways. So it would have to, you know, would have to be related to that. And also marginalized communities, whatever that looks like too. You know, just helping artists from different marginalized communities who may not have access, you know, to, you know, to the resources that they really need.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. Those are things like that we're looking at.
Supplies or tools and.
Excuse me. Or community. Yeah. You know, whatever that looks or, like. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Just workspace, period.
Yeah, I know. I have a, like, I'm painting the backdrop for a play and I didn't, like, I moved. So, like, the space I have now is smaller than the space I had before. And I'm just kind of like, I'm bringing it outside every once in a while to paint outside.
Yeah.
It's just so big. It's 8 by 16.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, we do what we can. Yeah, we do what we can, right?
Yeah, right now it's like tucked into like the side of my bedroom. And like, I've got a studio in here, but I can't get it down the stairs. And
oh, no.
I'm just like, how come, you know, I wish there was like a free large studio space in Niagara that I could just kind of like go to and just paint now that I'm like painting it. I'm like, oh, this was, this is kind of silly, but. You know.
Well, see, next time barter with a theater company to get some studio space where they are.
They're like an hour and a half away.
Oh,
yeah. So I didn't like. Yeah. I was so excited. I was like, oh yeah, and I had the space at the time, but now I moved. Hey, yeah, things happen.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Still get it done.
Yep.
One way or another.
Yeah.
But yeah, I love the idea of having studio space. That's, you know, available for 2 months because, hey, I have this project. Here's my proposal. I have to paint this ginormous thing for two. Hey, I'm coming to California. No, I'm just kidding. if you're closer.
Exactly.
Maybe. Yeah. But yeah, that would be cool to have around here.
Definitely.
Steve helped me pick up my wood from the Home Depot. Because it was... rather large for my vehicle. He helped me out.
You know something? I had a friend who was selling large canvases, like 57 by like 64 inches. No, they were like 5 by 7 feet, and even a couple that are 5 by 5 feet and 4 by 4 feet, and they wouldn't fit in the back of my car. And so I found an app called Lugg, L-U-G-G, where I put in the information. Within 2 hours, I had my canvases. One guy in a van picked them up, brought them here. It was like $75 delivery. I didn't have to worry about lifting, worry about finding a friend to help me. I was so happy to do that. I'm like, I am using them because I'm always like, I can't buy this because it won't fit in my car. I'm like, I will pay the extra money, you know, if I don't have to lift. So just putting that out there, there are ways. Unless you have great friends like Steve.
Yes. Hear that, Steve? I'm replacing you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Heartbroken.
Yeah. And I have a friend named Steve who also helps me a lot, but he was unavailable at this time. So.
Yeah. It's the worst when they're on sale at the art store and you can't take advantage of it.
I know.
Yeah. I miss my SUV at times like that.
Yep.
All right, Steve, do you have any other questions for Christine?
Not really. I just noticed a lot of your the work you do deals around your eating disorder. So is that mainly your main focus, of trying to deal with it, or?
You know, good question. Not necessarily. I mean, it is my eating disorder, but also just ideas of beauty and identity and who I am as a person. I'm also a painter though. So I'm an abstract painter. I draw, I do mixed media work that are completely abstract. Although a friend of mine critiqued my work recently, and she, because I do a lot of circles in my work, like the way my hand moves, like the way I pour the paint down. And she's like, I see your body in that. So I'm like, oh my God, you know, it's there unconsciously, you know, whether I want it to be or not. So, So it's not necessarily my eating disorder, but it's also my size, you know, just like being a curvy plus size woman, and what that means. And, you know, it's kind of, I mean, all of our work is all autobiographical, and my story just revolves around my eating disorder and being plus size and, you know, and like all of that.
Uncomfortable skin, your series there, yes. Or comfort and joy. It all seems to deal with that, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Let them eat cake.
Yes. And the Let Them Eat Cake was for Kim Abeles is an artist in Los Angeles. She's an amazing artist. She curated a show for Mother's Day and invited me to be in the show. And because my work, a lot of it, I use like food references. And so what I did was I shredded like a lot of my pages from my journals that had to do with like eating and growing up and, you know, things like that. And I put the shredded pages in like glass cake stands. And those were on like a baker's rack for the exhibition. And so people got it, you know, it was, it was a really great piece. And then Comfort and Joy, one of my binge foods was Yogurtland and, you know, frozen yogurt, and they give you plastic spoons. And it's like, you hate to throw these away because they're such good spoons and they are recyclable. But so I saved mine. And so I had like tons of spoons, and then I wanted more. So I actually contacted Yogurtland and they sent me like a box of 200 or 300 spoons. And so what I did was I painted them, like I dipped them in paint and I let them dry and the paint drip. I also wrapped some of them in thread and I sealed, like I put a bunch of them in vacuum sealed bags. And I hung like, I think there's like 50 of those on a wall in an installation. And it's all about comfort food and, you know, what it does. Sometimes it brings you joy and, you know, the idea of what comfort and joy is. So... and then I also did, a lot of my work involves deconstructing, you know, and reconstructing in different ways. So like those skinny photos that we talked about, I actually one night, a lot of my art is also impulsive. So sometimes nothing is planned. One night I was sitting there and I'm like, I need to do something with these photos for art, because they were just in an envelope in my, like in my bag that I carry around, you know, nothing art related at all. I was just sitting there, I need to do something. And so I brought out the paper shredder and I started shredding them. And I videotaped it. So I have videos of me shredding, you know, all of these photos, and you could see the photos in the video. What I did was I put them in, originally I put them in glass jars along with, and then I started, it was like,
is this early, the mannequin piece?
No, this was a different
part and put them in glass jars.
Was also another thing I did, but, the skinny photos, this was, I think in, what was it, like 2016, it was around the election, and, there was a lot of tension in my family, you know, with the election and everything. And so I also ended up shredding all of my family photos and negatives, because like years ago, have photos printed out at Walmart, you know, like, and so along with, and get the negatives. And so, so I shredded all of those and I made an installation with the video of me shredding them and then like the jars of the negatives and the photos. And I've since kind of repurposed it and I put the photos in like these clear plastic bags, but deconstructing my painted mannequins.
I think that's like my favorite.
Avatars.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was a whole installation also.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's pretty cool.
Thank you. I'm like, what else can I tear apart?
Yeah, well, I just like the idea that you painted the avatars and then cut them up and shoved them into, you know, kind of like, you live in LA, it's a plastic surgery, everything image is, you know, you're in the environment where, you know, so I just love the statement of just like, okay, well, let's cut you up then, ha ha ha, and shove you in a jar.
Exactly.
Want to be perfect? Here you go.
Yeah. I used to, before I cut them up, I had, I had like a total of 8, I think, painted mannequins. And I mean, some were, quote, plus size, according to Amazon. They were probably size 14, you know, so not even close to being plus size. But I would take them around to different places and take photos of them, like whether it was like some, they let me take it into Rite Aid and I'd take the photos in front of like the cosmetic, you know, the cosmetic aisles. And I like took pictures of them in front of like McDonald's. And when I traveled, I went up to San Francisco, I took one with me and I took pictures of her in different places. And so I have a whole series of photos, you know. In fact, I just shared them on Facebook today. A few years ago, I took one to the Grand Canyon. Cool. And I took photos of her in the Grand Canyon.
I'll have to go take a look at that.
Yeah.
I've always loved art with mannequins for some reason. It's intriguing to me.
Yeah, it depends on what it's for. Like mine had a more conceptual, you know, idea behind it, that they're actually, it's a representation of my avatar from Second Life. Because eventually Gracie became I put my painting as her skin. And so like I changed her in Second Life as I was changing in real life. And so we both went through this big transition. And so the mannequins in real life were like the avatar, like blurring the line between the physical and the virtual worlds, you know, in a way. So
yeah, so it's even deeper.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
So many layers.
And then I cut them up.
Yeah. That must have been fun.
Yeah. A friend helped me, but it was definitely fun playing with the saw. I mean, they're fiberglass too, so you had to be careful, but yeah.
Yeah, deconstruction.
Yep, exactly.
I just wanted to touch on the career change from emergency room to this success in the art world. And I wanted to know, do you feel like now you are living up to your full potential?
Good question. Throughout my life, I always like said the phrase, life is too short. You know, it didn't matter what I was doing in my life, that phrase was always there. I always struggled. Like I was never good with money. I was in and out of school. I had, you know, in and out of like apartments and roommates and stuff like that. But somehow, you know, even through all those struggles, I had the idea like life is too short. So you have to do what you love now. And so, you know, that got me through life for a long time, even with those struggles. And when I was working in the emergency room, which wasn't my ideal job, it was good because I was working 3 days a week, 12 hours a day. I had medical insurance. It was stable. But I was always an artist also. So it like working 3 days a week afforded me 4 days to work on my art, you know, and to be an artist. And so then they decided to change my hours to 5 days a week, 8 hours a day. Even though I had been there for 8 years, I was still like, you know, lower on the totem pole, like as far as seniority goes. And my hours would have been like 7 p.m. to 3 a.m. And I'm not a night person. Being in the art world, like I wouldn't have been able to go to openings. I'd have to work like every other weekend. I'm like, that's not going to work for me. And I had already started Shoebox PR. I was doing it part time. And I started it kind of on a whim. I had a solo show in 2012 and I didn't do any PR for it. And so I realized that, okay, I need to know the business of art. I need to know what it takes to be an artist today. You know, it's not just being in the studio. There's a lot more to it. So I started like taking classes, reading all the business of art books, and a friend of mine and I started studying together. And then he had a solo show that, you know, that he was going to find a PR person to promote. And, you know, I think it was like my birthday party or something. And I jokingly said, well, you know, you can hire me. And he called me up a week later and he's like, hey, let's talk about this. And so, so that was it. We talked about it. Within a week, I had the name of my business card, website, social media. And I promoted his show, which was a success. And then it was word of mouth. So I was doing that part-time while I was in the ER full-time. and I, like, you know, just other artists came to me for help. And then when they changed my hours in the ER, it was like within that year, I'm like, I can't do this. And I just decided to quit the ER and take Shoebox full time. And to this day, I don't know how I did it because I didn't have money in the bank. I mean, I was living paycheck to paycheck. It was crazy. I don't know how I did it. So, leap of faith. Yeah. And I built it up. And, you know, I had an intern, Shelly, who ended up like being a part-time employee. And now she's my manager. That was 6 years ago. You know, we've changed her name. And I'm always one to figure things out. And, you know, I'm very logical and, you know, all of that. But let me see. I mean, it goes back to life is too short and we do have to do what we love. We have to just, you know, I mean, I need to keep thinking about that now because of where I am with my eating disorder also. But I know there was a second part to your question and I'm so sorry. I think I
just
wondering
if you're, if you felt you were living up to your potential now.
Oh, with this change. Yes. And actually, no. That's a great question. And the answer is no. Whether it is in therapy with my eating disorder, I feel like there's a wall, and on one side of the wall is my potential, what I'd like to be doing, what I can see myself doing. And on the other side is where I am now. And it's really interesting because there's a lot I want to do and that I can see myself doing, but, you know, I'm not there yet.
Is it tied to your weight?
A little bit, or tied to having more energy, or, you know, being more fit and more active. And so I'm sure that has something to do with it. But I'll get there. I mean, I want a regular yoga practice, you know, or I want to do more performance art, or I want to do more residencies, or, you know, I mean, but it's also, it comes back to being kind to myself, which is something that I need to practice because I am very, very hard on myself. And I know I do a lot now. So it's like, you know, I really need to think about that.
When you recognize yourself being hard on yourself, you need some sort of gimmick. Either like an elastic band around the wrist or something, right? Because really deter you from, you know, it eats time and takes your brain and
I don't know what will work for me. I don't know yet. We'll see.
Figure it out. You know, it'd be really cute if you did yoga inside the new gallery space.
I've thought of that. Or sound baths or I've thought of that. So we'll have to see. Definitely.
Very cool.
Yep.
Well, thank you for spending time with us today.
This was wonderful.
Being so open.
You're welcome.
With your answers, yeah.
You're welcome. No, this was fantastic. I learned more about myself, you know, from talking to you also. So thank you.
That's great. Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure talking with you. And when you say you haven't lived up to your potential, it might be just the way you perceive yourself.
Yep.
Because other people see you differently and perceive me, right?
Exactly. Yeah. It all comes back to that, definitely. Yeah.
Thank you for listening. If you'd like to know more about Kristen Shoemaker, her link is in the description. If you would like to know more about Steve Wilson and his gallery in Niagara Falls, his link is also in the description. And if you'd like to know more about the activities and programs that I offer, you can visit my website, bwhimsyartloft.ca. If you would like to be a guest on the podcast, please do reach out. My email is artbyriannonberry@gmail.com.